Okay. Hello.
Hey, thanks for having us.
How you doing?
Oh, hey, Eric.
Oh, hey.
This is Eric. He's joining us in conversation today.
Yes, he's joined us in many conversations at many restaurants over the years. So welcome, and thanks for coming. And the way we're going to do this is I've got a bunch of questions for Kenji that he has decided not to have beforehand, to preserve some element of spontaneity, and then we'll open it up to questions from you all. So I'm going to start with something that was in the one of the first pages of the book, and you call yourself a nerd.
Yes.
And I'd like you to define that term as it relates to the book and your life.
Okay, I think a nerd, I mean, obviously I wear glasses, so that's the primary element that defines me as a nerd. No, I think a nerd is someone who gets really into the sort of details and wants to dive deeper than is maybe, than the average person would want to into a specific subject. To me, like, a nerd is sort of, I mean, similar to an obsessive, but someone who obsesses in a particularly sort of... In a particular way, in a nerdy way. So someone who obsesses in a sort of, I mean, hopefully slightly more intellectual, but I don't want to say that I'm an intellectual because I don't think I am. But
we're relentlessly middle brow.
Yes.
So was that always the case? I mean, your dad as a scientist.
I was always a nerd. I was definitely never a food nerd growing up. I didn't get into food. I didn't get into food until I got into cooking, and so I nerded out about cooking before I actually even enjoyed the fruits of my labor, and I didn't really get into cooking until I was like 20 years old, 19 years old. I accidentally fell into it because I was a science nerd. Like, I used to wake up 6 a.m. every morning to watch. I would wear my Winnie the Pooh onesies. I would get up at 6 a.m. to go watch Mr. Wizard.
He used to come to work in those onesies. Yeah.
I had to cut open the bottom so that they would, so that my feet could fit through. But I was into the science shows as a kid, and my parents wanted me to be a scientist or a doctor. So I had a very strong sort of science and math education, and was really into all that. I was never really into food or cooking, and I fell into cooking accidentally. It was the summer after my sophomore year of college that I sort of wanted to spend the summer doing non-academic stuff. And so I went around looking for a job as a waiter, and as it turns out, most restaurants aren't willing to hire a waiter with zero experience and, like, no good people skills, but...
Even though you were an MIT student, doesn't that count for something?
Negatively towards the people skills. But they're perfectly willing to hire a cook with no experience, apparently. Because one of the restaurants I walked into, they said, we don't have a waiter job, but we have a prep cook who didn't show up this morning. So if you can work this afternoon and you know how to hold a knife, then you can have a job. And I lied, and I said I knew how to hold a knife, and so I got a job in a restaurant kitchen. And that was the first time I'd ever really thought about cooking very much, and I fell in love with cooking pretty much instantly. And it wasn't until after I'd been cooking for a few months that I actually started to enjoy food.
That's really weird. Strange. I never had actually heard that before. So you didn't derive a lot of pleasure from food growing up.
No, I mean, my mom used to cook for us, and my mom's here somewhere, so I'm not gonna... I loved everything my mom cooked all the time. food was... my mom came from Japan when she was a teenager. My dad is American, but we didn't really have a lot of sort of, like, old family recipes, or we didn't have, like, the big family dinner on Sunday. You know, we ate dinner every night together and ate all our meals at home, but it wasn't, like... the sort of, like, big cultural personal thing that it is for a lot of people now. So we ate well, but I was never really that excited about it. And I remember, when I was a freshman in college, actually even a sophomore in college, I had a girlfriend, and Her parents came into town once and took us out to dinner, and we went to a really fancy restaurant in Boston. And I remember her parents and her ordered a tasting menu, and I didn't because I didn't like food. And I remember just looking at the menu and thinking, like, this one has fish, this one has oysters, this is vegetable. And in the end, I just ordered a steak, which is like the most boring thing you can possibly order at a fancy restaurant. But that's the kind of stuff I liked up until I, you know, started cooking and really getting into it.
That's really fun. I didn't know that. And you also, you met your wife through cooking.
Yes, I did. Yeah, yes.
Right?
I forgot about that. Yeah, I was,
I'm just saying.
for a number of years, I started cooking in restaurants while I was in college. I was cooking, part-time in college, and then I lived in a co-ed fraternity house in college, and, my senior year, I started cooking dinners for them. I took up, we found our cook doing lines of coke off the piano, so we fired him. I
don't
over...
know what the problem with that is.
So I took over the responsibilities of the cook, cooking dinner at the fraternity house. And then, actually, for a number of years after I graduated, I also cooked for the house. So my wife was in the same fraternity house, and I used to, yeah, I cooked dinner for my wife for, I guess, 3 years before we started dating.
That's really funny. So how did you go from food, from cooking, because you ended up cooking at some very serious Boston restaurants, right?
Yep.
You started in a Mongolian hot pot restaurant, right?
I started as a prep cook in a Mongolian grill. My first promotion was from prep cook to Knight of the Round Grill.
Awesome.
I think it's my most significant promotion also. I haven't had any sort of regal position since then.
Maybe I should call you Knight of the Round Serious Eats.
Yeah.
Knight of the Round Serious Eats.
And so you cooked like for Ken Oranger and a lot of serious restaurants. And did you find yourself getting more and more into the sort of nerdy side of what you were learning, or were you really immersed in just cooking for people?
When you're working in a restaurant, you don't really have the time to get immersed in the nerdy side. Restaurants are super high stress, super high adrenaline. Like, you know, your deadlines are counted in like seconds as opposed to days or weeks or months. And so you don't really have a lot of time to sort of explore the whys and the hows. It's more just the you focus a lot on the technique, and you focus on learning the process of the specific restaurant you're working in, learning the way they do it. But you don't have a lot of time to sort of explore. The natural questions that come up in cooking, like the why am I doing it this way? Why don't I do it a different way? How does this recipe work? Why does meat behave this way when you sear it, and this way when you boil it? And so there's all the, you know, you learn a lot of technique, but you don't learn a lot of the why and the theory behind the technique.
Got it.
So, yeah, I worked many years in restaurants, but I had this sort of backlog of questions building up as I did.
And I remember you telling me that one of the reasons you started experimenting with cooking as opposed to hard science is because you saw the results sooner.
I mean, I spent a couple summers working in biology labs in high school and in college. I started college as a biology major. I loved the theory and the hows and the whys, but that biology, the actual practice of biology was a little mind-numbing to me. It's like I'm spending my entire summer working on one experiment, and then most likely at the end of like 3 months, I'm going to get a result that isn't what I expected anyway, and I can't even eat it.
That's funny. So let's talk about Food Lab, the column, mm-hmm. Because that wasn't how you started working at Serious Eats. I think Adam hired you to write burger reviews.
The first story I wrote for Serious Eats was about burgers. Yeah, at the time I was trying to open a burger restaurant, and so as part of the research for opening the restaurant. Me and my partner drove from Boston to New York and ate at like 12 highly recommended burger places over the course of about 8 hours. That's still the kind of research I like best.
we came from 3 days in Los Angeles where we ate at, I don't know.
40 restaurants in 3 days.
40 restaurants in 3 days. My wife still can't quite believe that. But I
tapped out before you did. I took an afternoon off.
It's true. But so you started with the burger reviews, and then what happened? We had lunch.
Yeah.
That's right.
That's a leading question because he wants me to talk about him. Ed and I had lunch, and I was working freelance at the time because I had been in Boston working for Cooks Illustrated magazine for about 3 years, and then I moved back to New York with my wife, and I was working freelance as an editor for Cooks Illustrated, doing some stories for Serious Eats as well, and we had lunch, and you know, and I said,
"Why I did it?"
I said, "I've always wanted to write a column on food science," and Ed said, "Oh, well, you should write a column on food science," and then that's how the food lab started.
It's true. And then I said, "No, let's call it food lab," you know.
Well, originally it was going to be a column on burger science, and I think you were trying to make like a portmanteau of like burger and laboratory. And I think originally the column was going to be called Burgatory. Or something? Burgatory?
Sounds like something stupid I would suggest. So what's interesting is, were there models for what you ended up doing as a food lab column? Like, what were your inspirations, or what was your methodology, and how did you develop it?
There are many, many models. Alton Brown does a great job of doing very similar things. Then there's also like the more high-end stuff like Modernist Cuisine and Ideas in Food. And then of course there's Cooks Illustrated, which does a very similar thing, but a little bit more boring, I think. For me, I think the biggest model for what I do is not food related. I think it's Mr. Wizard, you know, the guy I watched as a kid growing up. That was the biggest influence because every sort of scientific concept, every concept in physics and chemistry and thermodynamics that I learned up until college, as I got better and better at science, I learned more of the math behind it. But from a conceptual level, I think I learned every single thing I know about science from Mr. Wizard by the time I was like 8 years old. And
we're
it's just because
ourselves, because you know, the younger members of the audience might not know who Mr. Wizard was.
What's Mr. Wizard?
Mr. Wizard was his real name is Don Herbert. He had two different television shows. One that ran in the mid 50s to the early 60s, and then another one that ran in the early 80s. And he did a really great job of explaining sort of difficult, complex scientific topics in a way that everybody can understand. His sort of spiritual predecessor, what's the one that comes after the predecessor?
Successor,
yes. It would be like someone like Bill Nye, the science guy, something like that. The Mythbusters guys now do sort of similar things, some real testing that people can do at home or exploding things, which is also fun. But explaining science in a way that people can understand, which is what I try and do.
I always describe you, or I have, as sort of Harold McGee meets The Simpsons, because it's a scientific methodology in a pop cultural context.
I guess that's fair. I try and explain science, and I definitely use pop culture references and try and use language that people can relate to and can understand, because I think you're much more likely to absorb and process information when it's explained to you by like a friend or someone who sort of understands you. And it's not, I sat through college lectures and high school lectures, and that's an okay way to learn things if you're willing to really sit down and like open a book and force yourself against your will to do it. You can make yourself learn things, but I think most people learn a lot better when things are explained in a context that they can relate to, And that sort of hits more of their senses than just like their intellect, you know. So something that hits the humor and the visual and all these things, I think, help you actually retain knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and you know, it injects humor and a sort of personal touch, you know. And Harold McGee is a brilliant writer and
yeah.
food scientist, but. no one would ever confuse his writing with yours, you know?
No, yeah, because he's way smarter than I am.
No, that's not true. That's not true. So tell us what your process is like. So take it from the start of any Food Lab column and go to the end.
The very beginning is like the pre-research. And that's when I'm sort of deciding what subject I'm going to write about. And most often that involves talking to people like on social media, on the internet, talking to friends, reading other books, and sort of seeing what is interesting to people and what kind of recipes people are looking for. So first of all, it's deciding what recipe I'm going to write about, and that's always like. I try to do like the intersection of what is interesting to other people and what's interesting to me, because they don't necessarily overlap, but I want to hit that kind of sweet spot in the middle.
So you try to do it like a Venn diagram there?
Yeah, a Venn diagram of...
It's the only scientific thing I know, so that's why I don't say it.
So it starts there, and then it goes into research, and the research is not necessarily scientific research, it's more sort of historical and cultural research. Like, what I really try to do is... You know, say I'm working on a recipe for meatloaf or macaroni and cheese. I want to figure out what meatloaf means to people, because the last thing I want to do is arrive at a final recipe that doesn't hit like all those points of meatloafiness. When I do a recipe for meatloaf,
we develop words like meatloafiness every day.
Burgerness.
Burgeriness, yes. When I write a recipe for a burger, I want to make sure that when someone eats that burger, it's the most burgery burger they've had. Because, you know, there are a lot of, and this is not necessarily a bad thing, but there's a lot of modern chefs who take a sort of deconstructionist approach to food, and they'll think, all right, what are the elements in a burger? And now I'm going to take those apart and I'm going to rethink them and put together something that challenges you, like challenges your notion of what a burger is. And that's not really what I try to do.
Yeah,
like, I'm not trying to challenge your notion of what a burger is. I want you to have the burger and all the sort of cultural and historical and traditional things that means to you, and all the comfort, because you know food ultimately is about comfort and tradition and feeding people and like coming together. And I think it's not really for most people, food is not an intellectual thing. It's a carnal
thing.
It's
a visceral thing.
Yes, it's a visceral thing and I don't want to lose that. So when I'm developing a recipe for a burger. I'll think what it is that makes a burger to most people, and make sure that is my end goal. Is to push the flavor or the idea of burgeriness up to 11.
So you start there.
So I start there. Yes. So I start out with a set of parameters, what I want my end recipe to be, and then from there I'll start talking to more people and figure out what parts they might have trouble with, in a traditional recipe, see what elements might give people trouble, what elements they are unhappy with in the existing recipes. And so that gives me sort of an idea of what I want to try and optimize or streamline or foolproof. And then a lot of it is also looking at existing recipes out there and seeing, again, seeing like stages where I think maybe they're doing this not because it's going to make the end result better, but because they were taught that when they were a kid or when they were learning from another chef. And you find oftentimes that the things you were taught that you just sort of blindly accept are not always the best way to do things. And so designing experiments and running tests to test those things can tell you whether it really is the best way or whether maybe there's a slightly better way. And the better way, it's not always just to throw out tradition, but it's generally to try and make it more foolproof, or to try and make it better than what exists.
And how much time it takes doesn't really bother you, because there are often you embark on a series of experiments, like your chocolate chip cookie recipe, which I don't think is in the book.
It's not in the book.
But it was you really
deconstructed every element of the chocolate chip cookie, you know, from the flour to the sugar to the chocolate, and then you were like, okay, how do I arrive at the best chocolate to use in a chocolate chip cookie?
Yeah, and you know, and that so the degree in which I dive into a recipe depends on you know, how important that recipe is and sort of the lexicon, like the standard lexicon of recipes. So chocolate chip cookies, like, they mean a lot of things to a lot of people. So you that's the one, you know, that's a recipe you want to make sure you're not going to mess up.
They're fraught with meaning.
They are, and you know, and they're also you know, they're also remarkably complex, and oftentimes I find that the recipes that appear simplest and the ones that we just take for granted, you know, boiled eggs, chocolate chip cookies, poached eggs, meatloaf, like all these things that seem really simple and that everybody's familiar with, those are the ones that often have like the most sort of myth and lore surrounding them, and the most number of things that are just kind of taken for granted, because people just, all right, like, these are the chocolate chips I grew up eating. This is how my grandmother made it. This is how my mother made it, or this is how my chef made it, or my father, or whoever. And that's how I'm going to make it. So you know, there are a lot of things that people just take for granted, which is totally fine. You know, if you have a chocolate chip recipe, cookie recipe that you've been passing down generation to generation in your family, and you're happy with the process of making it, and you're happy with the end results, then like, there's no reason you should change that. But at the same time, you know, often understanding sort of the underlying scientific principles. And the basic chemistry and thermodynamics under there, you find that maybe it does help you think about it in a slightly different way, and maybe even like improve it and enhance some of the qualities that you love about it, while at the same time not losing anything that makes it important to you.